City of Chattanooga on this chilly spring day. But you know what? Hey everybody. I am alive with the Spirit of God. 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 I am alive with the Spirit of joy. 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 Peace. I am alive with the Spirit of 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 God. 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 Let's do it again. I am alive with the Spirit of God. 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 Yeah. The Spirit of God is upon me. Oh, the Spirit of God is upon me. Oh, the Spirit of God is upon me. Oh, the Spirit of God is upon me. And hold it. The Spirit of God is upon me. Oh, oh, the Spirit of God is upon me. Oh,
how's that feel?
Oh, and surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel God's mighty power and God's grace. There's a holy hush around us. I see love in every face. Of the Lord is in this place.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
In Unity churches everywhere, the service begins by lighting the Christ candle. This symbolizes the beginning of our sacred time together. And it's also a visual representation of the light and the love of God that is with us always. And please join me now in prayer. As we begin, take a nice deep breath and allow yourself to relax into the allness of God. And for a moment, we leave behind the cares of the world. In this space, there is no conflict, no competition, no lack, no limitation. There is only the peace and perfection of the divine that blesses and supports all life. And as the world gets ready to celebrate Earth Day, I invite you to see spring as so much more than just a changing of the seasons. We acknowledge the memory of winter's sleep, and we give gratitude for the springtime that is full of promises for all the good things to come. It is a time when the human soul revives itself, revealing the holy love that is continually growing deep within our hearts. And as the world awakens to celebrate the return of color and the rebirth of wonder, we celebrate the promise of new life, because this is a time of rebirth for our spirit. Spring is the proof that there is beauty in new beginnings. And we have come here to transform our lives, to heal together, and to create something better than what we knew before. It's also a time for a little spring cleaning. We get to sweep away the self-doubt, the worry, the jealousy, the regret, the anger, or any guilt that holds us back from living a happy and fulfilled life. And in the moment of the awareness to the beauty and the awe of spring, we are reminded that the magic in life is not gone just because we hit a bump in the road. The bumps are just challenges to your ego, but not to your destiny. Flowers don't worry about how they're going to bloom. They just open up and turn towards the light and become all that they are meant to be. So behold, spring has come. It's just like a green traffic light signaling the world that it's time to go. It's time for you to go. Or as Terry Lovelace would say, party time. Thank you, sweet spirit, for this reminder of how beautiful change can truly be. And we are grateful for all the new beginnings and second chances. We ask that you guide us in making the most of them. I close with an old familiar unity saying, the best is yet to be, and so it is. Amen.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel God's mighty power and God's grace. There's a holy hush around us. I see love. The Lord is in this place. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Believe within your heart you know that no one can change the path that you must go. Believe what you feel and know you're right, because the time will come around when you say it's yours. Believe there's a reason to be. Believe you can make time stand still. You know from the moment you'll try. If you believe, I know you will. Believe in yourself right from the start. You'll have brains, you'll have a heart, and you'll have courage to last your whole life through. If you believe in yourself, if you believe in yourself, if you believe in yourself as I believe in you.
Here today, filling up all the chairs practically. It's great to see a combination of unity of Christchurch unity and unity of Chattanooga people here too.
We're all one.
We are all one.
Amen.
And what an awesome bunch of ones we are. And good morning to everyone watching on Facebook at Unity of Chattanooga's Sunday Online Experience. We're so glad you're joining us. Please say hi as you join in and be sure to like today's service. We hope that you will engage with us with your comments or questions. There are always a lot of people who make this service happen. We have Landis Batts on the piano, Tony Carter on sound, and Eva Carter. I've got here Laura Miller, and that's just not the same. live streaming the service. Thank you, Eva. And our guest speaker today is Reverend Annie Sims. It looks like we have some newcomers here today. So we are honored to have you join us today. Our ushers have a special packet of information about the Unity Movement for you. And there is a paper on the back that you can fill out and put in the offering basket if you would like to receive our bi-monthly email newsletter. We also want to extend a special blessing to you. So warm up our hands as we say together, we love you, we bless you, we appreciate you, and we uphold the Christ in you. The Christ in you refers to that spark of divinity, the very same quality of being that Jesus found and brought forth in himself and demonstrated in his ministry. At Unity of Chattanooga, we try to live up to our name, Unity, by celebrating the worth and dignity of all people.
We honor all paths to God, and wherever you are on your spiritual journey, you are welcome here. We are a spiritual community that offers practical tools and resources to people of all faiths. We encourage people to stay positive and apply universal principles to their daily lives. The Unity Movement blends ancient wisdom teachings with new thought, practical Christianity, and provides people around the world with positive spiritual messages of hope, healing, prosperity, and peace. Earth Day this year is April 22nd. This year's theme is Planet versus Plastic, and the goal is for a 60% reduction in the production of all plastics by 2040. Oh my, we could get bogged down in fear, couldn't we, about all the issues facing our planet. But at Unity, we have a different way. We give thanks for the good that we see and that we experience. The greening of all the trees in our beautiful area, the blossoming of all the beautiful flowers in our yards and our neighbors. Then we open up our hearts to a new vision of a peaceful, abundant, healthy planet. And we say, yes, God, thank you. This, or something even better. And then we take the next best step, whatever that is inspired in us. Here at Unity of Chattanooga, we have provided a container in the kitchen to recycle plastics and aluminum cans. That's a small step, but everything good begins with a small step, doesn't it? Speaking of the future, now is the time in our service where you get to welcome each other this morning with a smile, a fist bump, a hug, whatever you're comfortable with. Stand up and greet your neighbor.
Hi, how are you? Good to see you. Hello.
So am I. How are you?
Yeah.
I see you're responding to the gong nowadays. We are welcome. We are excited to welcome back Reverend Annie Sims, who recently received her ordination from the Universal Brotherhood Ministries. Annie taught Conversations with God classes for 2 years at the Nashville Center for Spiritual Living and served as music director of the Music City Center for Spiritual Living before relocating to Los Angeles in 2014. Annie Sims has personally trained with Neil Donald Walsh since 2005. Today, in addition to her duties as the author and instructor of her book called Wisdom That Works with the Conversations with God online school, Annie serves as treasurer of the board of the Conversations with God Foundation and is one of four Conversations with God life coaches in Neil Donald Walsh's spiritual mentoring programs for private clients worldwide. We are delighted that she has moved back to our area. And we are even and we are even more delighted to welcome her back to Unity of Chattanooga today. Please help me give a warm welcome to Reverend Annie Sims.
Aw, that was the sweetest thing. Thank you. My husband's like, they're calling you Reverend Annie now. It's the first time I've actually heard this, to tell you that. I know, he used to call me Preacher Annie. I'm like, oh gosh, preach it. I didn't really set out to be a minister, to tell you the truth. I just found my passion with conversations with God. Honestly, before my sister pushed book three into my hands and said, pick a page, any page, and just read one, and all it took was a paragraph. Before that, I didn't even know if I believed in God anymore. But then it's like, well, this certainly rings true. Hey, how many people have read at least one Conversations with God book by Neil Donald Walsh? You have? Which one did you read? Which one have you read, honey? Conversations with God for Teens? Okay, how many have read more than one book? Oh, the hands are much fewer. More than three or more? Okay, well, maybe I should tell you all, it certainly didn't stop with Conversations with God, the first book. There's books 1, 2, and 3 in that what we call the trilogy. Then he wrote a book called Friendship with God, was his fourth book, which I'm going to speak out of something from this today. This is largely autobiographical, as well as dialogue, questions, answers. If you don't know what Conversations with God is, Neil was at the breaking point in his life, and he was almost ready to do himself in at the age of 50, and that's when the conversation started coming through. He asked questions of spirit and received answers in his mind and wrote them all down, never dreaming it would be a book. And then it became, he's written so many books, I've lost count. But Friendship with God came next. Communion with God, Tomorrow's God, The New Revelations, What God Wants, When Everything Changes, Change Everything. He has like 9 or 10 books in the Conversations with God cosmology. Then he started writing the Conversations with Humanity series. There's a whole bunch of those. And then he came back. Did I mention Home with God and A Life That Never Ends? That's very important if you know of anyone who's going through a transition of a loved one in your life, or you might want to read it for your own. It's about Home with God and A Life That Never Ends. Yeah, from one realm to the other. You know, it's just a doorway to both realms. But anyway, where was I? Oh, yeah. So just a couple of years ago, he would wake up at like 4:30 in the morning, and that's when the messages would come through. A couple of years ago, he felt another one coming, and it turned out to be Conversations with God, Book 4, Awaken the Species. So we now have, instead of a trilogy, we have 4. But anyway, what I want to speak about today is an excerpt from this book, Friendship with God. And it's on the 3 levels of awareness is where we were given this. Does anybody have a guess or a knowing of what the 3 levels of awareness are from Conversations with God? Anybody want to venture a guess?
I do because you told me, but I won't say anything.
You're disqualified. Okay. All right. There are three levels of awareness around everything, and I quote, these are hope, belief, and knowing. When you have a hope about something, you are wishing that it is true, or you're wishing that it will happen. You are not certain in any sense of the word. When you have a belief about something, you are thinking that it is true or that it will happen. You are not certain, but you think you are certain, and you continue to think so unless something to the contrary appears in your reality. But when you have a knowing about something, you are clear that it is true or that it will happen. You are certain in every sense of the word, and you continue to be certain even if something to the contrary appears in your reality. You judge not by appearances because you know what is so. So I'd like to talk a little bit about those three levels. Hope. When we want something in our lives, it always begins with hope, doesn't it? I hope this will happen. I hope I find my dream house, or I hope I find the man of my dreams, or I hope I can beat this cancer. It begins with hope. And hope is not a bad place to be. It's certainly better than hopelessness, okay? But the thing about when you're residing at the level of hope, which is the least magnetic, as you can imagine, you know, the higher up you go in awareness, the more magnetic it is. They're all magnetic. But when you reside at the level of hope, you may have some thoughts to the contrary. What we call in conversations with God, the sponsoring thoughts, the thought behind the thought behind the thought. And it may be buried so deeply you're not even really clear that you hold a sponsoring thought that's contrary to what you want, but it's there. Come on in. As we say in Tennessee, come on in. So some of you know that I'm a recording artist. And I spent about 10 years trying to make it in country music, whatever make it means. But I was always just at the level of hope. You know, when you're at the level of hope without at least believing it's going to happen, and certainly not without knowing it's going to happen, when you're at the level of hope, if you get anything of what it is that you're hoping for, it kind of comes in fits and starts, if at all. So I was just learning about the law of attraction back then. This has been a minute ago. And with my friends, so we would do these things like create dummy music row charts and put my song at number one or whatever. But I certainly didn't really believe it. So the sponsoring thought that I held was, I didn't really think that was going to happen. I knew darn well that was a fool's chart right there I had on the refrigerator. So the sponsoring thought is the most magnetic. So what was I getting in my experience? More hoping, but nothing much was happening. So beginners in the process of personal creation, as Neil calls it, or law of attraction, sometimes give up at that point. They say, well, this stuff doesn't work, so I give up. So that's hope. Have any of y'all ever hoped for something really hard and it never came to pass? Yeah. So I invite you to take just a moment to reflect. What do you think the truth was that you held about that hope that didn't happen? What do you think your sponsoring thought might have been? Could it be contrary to what your hope was? Yeah, getting some nods. Me too. So have you ever hoped for something and it did happen? Well, did you have a stronger feeling of awareness, maybe more of a belief, maybe more of a knowing? Okay. Well, so belief is the second level of awareness. And do we have any Abraham Hicks fans in the room? Yeah, my husband, I just came off an Abraham Hicks 10-day cruise last month. It was amazing. So I follow Abraham Hicks a whole lot, as well as Conversations with God. And Abraham says that a belief, does anybody know what Abraham says a belief is? Yes, a thought you just keep thinking over and over. A belief is just a thought you keep thinking over and over. And sometimes when there's something that we want to manifest in our lives, we think, well, if I think it long enough and hard enough, maybe it'll come to pass. Or if it's a belief system that we hold, if I think it long and hard enough, maybe it'll really be true. But you know, it's interesting that also when Neil lists the three levels of awareness, he also uses the word faith for belief in this second level of knowing, faith. You know, and we have different ideas maybe about what faith is. Faith to my dad is a whole different thing than it is to me, as he's a Southern Baptist. Country Southern Baptist from Hamblin County. And I mean, as little girls, we would go to that church with him on one Sunday, and then we'd go to the Episcopal church with my mother on other Sundays, and we definitely gravitated to the Episcopal church because that preacher scared the hell out of me. Which is what I think he was trying to do. But so he would just yell from the pulpit, and you have to believe this or you're not going to heaven. You're going to go to hell. So I think that kind of religious upbringing, I'm sorry if that offended your sweet little ears. That kind of religious upbringing is asking people to have blind faith. You know, it's disregard what your brain says. Disregard what your gut says. Just have blind faith that this is true. So you may be at the level of faith or belief because you either want it to be true or you might think you're supposed to believe it. And I think that's kind of indoctrination. But on the positive side of belief, it's certainly stronger than hope. So it is more magnetically attractive. But what I really want to talk about is that third highest level of awareness, which is knowing. It's the most powerful. Maybe you have a deep down feeling that something's already come to pass and the process is just playing itself out. Conversations with God says that we are all intuitive. We're all psychic at some level. So it could be there's a little bit of that intuition coming into play that you just know. So before I met my beloved 36 years ago, by the way, our 34th anniversary is a week from tomorrow. Yay, my Greg, best thing that ever happened to me. Before I met him, I had been in a relationship for 7 years and it didn't last, and thank God it didn't. But anyway, I had a number of years by myself and I've been a piano bar entertainer most of my life. And so these couples would come up and ask me to play the anniversary waltz. We're celebrating our 10th anniversary. And I'd play it for them. And then I'd say, how do you know when it's the right person? I would ask them. And guess what they all said? Exactly. And it drove me crazy. I'm like, what do you mean you just know? And they look at each other and then look at me. You just know. Oh, we're getting some hugs now. I know. So it was like the first time we went out, we talked for 3 hours. And then he walked me. We were working on board a cruise ship, y'all. It was funny. So he walked me down to my cabin in the bowels of the ship. And he kissed me goodnight. I'm like, oh, okay. And then I turned around and I put my key in the lock. And I just had to turn around and look at this person. I'm like, and right when he was halfway up the stairs, Greg turned around and looked at me. And we locked eyes. It's like we knew something was going on. Something was going on. I have another experience. It was an incredible knowing. We had lived in, when we jumped ship, we moved to Orlando. And we were there for like 15, 16 years. And it came time to move home to Tennessee. We're both from East Tennessee. It was time to come home. We decided to go to Nashville at that point because I already had these records going and everything. But we did an Abraham Hicks process on list the aspects in a home that you want. And so I had my list and he had his list, and it did not seem like those two could go together. He wanted a mountain house in Nashville, which, number one, is not in the mountains. I wanted a swimming pool. We lived in Orlando without a pool. So we wanted a mountain house with a pool in Nashville. It's like, whatever. Okay, so we just put it out there to the universe. And we went looking. We found it on the third day. We were looking at houses. I have a lot of threes in my life. And as soon as we drove past this house, and it was a for sale by owner with the price on it, right in our range, near the top, but in the range, I knew. I mean, I knew. I don't kid you when I say I felt like every cell in my body went buzz. That's it, that's it, that's it. And he was driving. I'm like, turn around, stop, stop, hurry, hurry, hurry. We got to go get it. It's our house. And we went in. We met the lady. She let us in. We had a handshake deal. She wouldn't even take my check. She's like, it's your house. And I said, okay, it's our house. And so we got back to Florida. We were going to put our house on the market. Her husband called. He had been out of town. He called me and he said, what makes... I didn't put a contingency. That's what it was. We didn't put a contingency to sell our Florida house to buy that one because I did not want a weak contract. I wanted a strong as I could get contract. And he said, what makes you think you're going to sell your house? I said, oh, it's going to sell. I know it's going to sell. So there was that knowing of that too. I knew that was my house and I knew that one was no longer my house. We put a sign in the yard. Next day we had a full price offer. Well, not full price, but close. So I want you all to think of a time in your life when you just knew something was going to happen or something felt right and it proved itself out in your experience. Think of a time that you had a knowing like that. I would love to hear a couple of your stories if anyone would like to share one. We all have them. These are powerful stories. Yay! What's your name?
Melissa.
What was it you were?
It was just like gifts, like that vase of flowers.
Oh, okay.
Some certificate to flowers at a shop or whatever. So I just sat there and I just thought, I know I'm going to win. I never win. And sure enough, I did. And the minute I won it, it came to me that I was to give that to this Nino Stimson.
I love it.
Like you, I wasn't supposed to win it.
Oh. That's beautiful. Thank you. Anybody else? Okay, what's your name?
Carol.
When I was pregnant, I had been married for 11 years. Didn't think I was ever going to have a child. But when I saw a picture of my husband, when he was a child, when he was about 2 years old, and he had on this white outfit with his arm across, you know, a little beret, and I said, my son's going to look just like that. He said, well, how do you know? The doctor says you can't have any kids. I said, no, I'm going to have it. So I get pregnant, and I go to the doctor, and of course, you know, that they check you, and I didn't want to know the sex or anything. So when my water breaks and I get to the hospital, the nurse is checking me, and she said, oh, it's going to be a little girl. And I said, what do you mean a little girl? No, it's a boy. She said, no, there's no testicles. And I said, no, you're wrong. And I said, it's a little boy.
Wow.
I said, get somebody else in here. Wow. So they went and got another nurse, and they checked, and I said, oh my gosh, they said the baby's breech. And so what she was feeling was the butt.
Oh.
They had to prep me for a C-section. And of course it was a baby.
Did you name him for his father?
Pardon?
Did you name him for his father by any chance?
No,
oh, wow. That's beautiful. Both of those are beautiful. Thank you all so much for illustrating how powerful this is. So here's the question. How can we use this? This is about with Conversations with God. So yes, I'm an instructor, author instructor of the Conversations with God online school, and this book is based on it that I have in there called Wisdom at Works, how to use the messages of Conversations with God. I want to know how I can use all these spiritual principles, right? So how can we use this? Can we raise our awareness from hope to belief? Yeah? Can we raise belief to knowing? Challenging. I believe we can. But in order to do so, I think we really have to get clear on what that sponsoring thought is. What's the thought behind the thought behind the thought that I hold about this? And, you know, conversations with God calls this not only the realm of the physical and the realm of the relative, meaning relativity, it also calls this the realm of illusion. So are there any illusory thoughts that I'm holding that are keeping me from manifesting all that I am? I mean, if we are, as all the religious texts say, is that my bell? I'm time's up. Okay. If we are, okay, I'll wrap it. Okay, if we are these three things, if we are omniscient, omnipresent, and omnipotent, how about that omnipotence? If we're all powerful, then we should be able, if we're aspects of the divine, which I believe fully that we are, then any illusory thought that we hold that keeps us from at least believing, even better, knowing, we want to root those out. We want to root out the sponsoring thoughts, and that's how we raise our level of awareness. Most people think that seeing is believing, but if there's something that you want to manifest in your life, I invite you to turn that around to believing is seeing. No matter what. No matter what. We all have examples of that, don't we? I had one, but the gong's gone off, so I do want to give you one. Go ahead. It's okay? Oh, okay. Well, when I was in Nashville, a dear friend of mine, she was my prayer partner at the Nashville Center for Spiritual Living, she wanted to put on a benefit concert for a dear friend who had become paralyzed in a tractor accident. And we were putting on this benefit together with a bunch of ladies that went to traditional churches. And it was the week before the concert, and we had only sold like 25 tickets. And these ladies were like, we need to cancel this. And this woman, Michelle Prentice, God love her, she's like, oh no, I see this room is filled. This room will be filled. She was almost like, oh, ye of little faith. It was a huge room. And by golly, Amy Grant came through at the last minute and signed on board to perform, and we sold out. And I think those ladies learned a big lesson that day of the power of believing is seeing. Anyway, one last thing. As Abraham Hicks says, if there's anything you want to manifest into your life, envision it in your mind for 17 seconds. That's how long it takes for the mind to forge new neural pathways. And you can even incrementally, 17 seconds, 4 times 17 seconds, they say is even longer, 68 seconds. Oh, that's when the new neural pathways come in, is 68 seconds. So it's like, that's wild stuff. So just hold the vision in your brain, believe it, and try to work toward knowing. Work toward knowing, work toward knowing. Okay? That's it. I hope it helps you. I hope it helps you. Aw, y'all are too kind. Thank you. So I did this meditation with Ram Dass when we lived in LA. And I would like to begin the meditation now with what he taught us. Does everybody know who Ram Dass is? He smiled from ear to ear with his eyes closed the whole time, and he repeated this mantra, I am loving awareness. I am loving awareness. So let's close our eyes. Let's go to the quiet place within. Let's know together that each of us is loving awareness. Now, there are two ways to interpret that. You can be the thing called awareness and the adjective being loving. What kind of awareness am I? Well, I'm loving, lovingly aware. I'm loving awareness. Also say, I am doing this thing called loving, and what I'm loving is awareness. It works both ways. Take a deep breath. As we breathe in new life. We breathe in loving awareness. As we exhale, we let go of anything that does not serve us in our lives. We inhale love and light, and we exhale negativity. We exhale judgment. We exhale criticism of others. We breathe in oneness, and we exhale separation. We are loving awareness. We are loving awareness. I am. The two most powerfully creative words in the universe are I am. I am loving words. We take that into the silence, to the quiet place inside.
Thank you so much. That was awesome.
That was very
inspiring.
Thank you.
Well, now's the time in our service where we give the opportunity to give back. And we also want to invite all you guys that are joining us on Facebook to also contribute and join in with us, because, you know, money is a reciprocal energy, right? So we have that knowing. That's the key, is that knowing that it's coming back to you, multiplied, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. So say it with me. Divine love flows through me. All that I have, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. I give in love, and I receive in abundance. And so it is. Thank you.
you for my help and healing, shining with your inner light. Thank you for each happy feeling, helping me to know what's right. Thank you for your inspiration. May I always hear your voice. Thank you for your gentle guidance, showing me my highest choice. Thank you for this gift I'm giving. May its goodness never end. Thank you for this life I'm living. By your grace, this prayer I send.
Father, we just thank you for these gifts. We thank you for this abundance. We thank you for the blessings on our church and for all the people that are here today and all the families that are represented. We just love you and we appreciate you. And so it is. Amen.
I want to remind you, thank you, Annie,
for thank
you. Wonderful words. And if you want more of Annie Sims, there are CDs and books in the back room for sale. So please enjoy that. Go back and look. And here's what's happening at Unity of Chattanooga. The first thing I would like to mention is our new bookstore, gift shop, and lending library, all in one. Be sure to check it out after the service. Every Thursday at noon, Eric Miller and Gino Petro host a group called Wellness Warriors. This is a positive, practical support group for people who are dealing with health issues, where you can share your challenges and share your victories as well, and set your health intentions. Then on Thursday evenings, the second and fourth Thursday evenings, which the fourth is coming this Thursday at 6:30 p.m., Amanda Adamson and Kelly Thompson will facilitate our metaphysical discussion group. That's the second and fourth Thursdays of every month. On the other Thursdays, first and third, we're having a belly dance class with Amanda Neufeld. We enjoyed it so much. This Thursday was our first time, and we had a ball. There were six people that came, in addition to our teacher, Amanda Neufeld, who usually sits up here on the front row. And there were two new people that had never been to Unity before. So it was fun. And look for us on the first and third Thursdays at 6:30. The classes are offered for $15 a piece. Next Sunday, we have lined up another talented musician and speaker, Christy Snow, from Charlotte, North Carolina. We have a special evening planned with Christy the night before, Saturday night, not at our home, but here, at our home. We will have a meet and greet and potluck at 6 p.m., and then Reverend Christy will give a concert starting at 7 on a love offering basis. We hope you will stay after the service and enjoy each other's company for fellowship and food. As we set up the tables, you can either lend a hand or you can check out our bookstore, gift shop, lending library, and Annie Sims books and CDs in the room behind me. But for now, let's stand and join in singing the peace song.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment.